Boy, they got up this morning feeling their Cheerios, didn't they? All that upbeat. You have to be young to have that kind of energy this early in the day, believe me. For the few of you who don't know me yet, I am Sam Owens. I had the joyful privilege of serving this church as pastor from October 2001 till November of 2015, so 14 years and 1 month, and I'm the old man in the on the back row back there now, most of the time, a back row Baptist. Fill in here whenever Brother Barry gives me the opportunity. I got to preach the last Sunday of 2017 and the first Sunday of 2018. Now here I'm here and today, and looks like, Lord willing, I get a chance to preach again on January 20th while the men are gone to the ski retreat. So it's great because, you know, you can retire from being a pastor. You can't retire from being a preacher, and their sermons are always coming out of the Bible and just banging on me. So today I get to preach you a whole year's worth of accumulated. No, I won't do that. We are here at the end of 2018 looking into a new year ahead of us. And, you know, it's common to go around wishing everybody Happy New Year, Happy New Year, Happy New Year. I would like to encourage Christians to change that happy to blessed. There's a world of difference between being happy and being blessed. So, blessed New Year. I know you have your hopes and wishes for what this new year will bring, and you hope it'll bring the same thing to all the people that you love and care for, and you're wishing everybody a blessed or a happy new year. Your parents, your kinfolk, all of you, I'm sure. I think God desires that we all have a blessed new year every year. So we're going to kind of take a look today at what I call an old plan for a new year. This, I believe, is one of God's formulas for helping all his children have a great year, every day of every year, if they follow this formula. Now, if you study the science of learning, you know that some people learn by hearing, some by seeing or reading, and some by doing. So we're going to try to incorporate all three of those things into the sermon today. I want us to read the text for today's sermon in the form of a responsive reading. So Renee, if we can get that up here on the screen. I'm going to read the odd-numbered verses, and you're going to read the even-numbered verses. And in case you don't know what even-numbered is, I've underlined them for you. I'm just helpful that way. I just can't control myself sometimes. So we're going to read this as a responsive reading. It's the first six verses of Psalm 113. So I'll read my part, and then you read your part, and that way we'll all have the text firmly in our mind. Praise the Lord. Praise, O servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. From the rising of the sun to its going down, the Lord's name is to be praised. Who is like the Lord our God who dwells on high? Pray with me, please. Father, we thank you that you've steered us successfully and safely through the year just passed, and we're thankful that you're opening the door to new opportunities in the year to come. We want, Lord, to always be people who have blessed days in our walk with you, in our relationship with you. Lord, as we deal with this text here this morning, I ask simply that your Holy Spirit help us to ingest it, digest it, and then metabolize it so that it become actually a part of who we are. We just want to take it with us when we leave here and remember it throughout the coming year and have it, Lord, be a blessing to us, a source of instruction to us. We pray for that. We always just open our hearts and minds to you and say, Lord, have your way in our lives as we deal with your word. That's what we ask for here this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There is a thing called the formula for investigating reporting. That's where you go around asking the question, who, what, when, where, why, and how. We're going to kind of apply that technique to the diagnosing this text this morning. We're going to kind of do it quickly because I want to get to the conclusion as quickly as I can because there's some important things to say there. We're not going to do it exactly in the order that I just gave them to you, but we're going to look at this thing. We're going to ask all those W questions and then the how question at the very end. Let's start with the question, what? What are we to do? If we wanted to have the most blessed new year of our lives coming up, what should we do all year long? And the answer is right there on the screen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Every day, all day, and we'll get to that more in the future. Now look who is speaking to here. O servants of the Lord, praise the name of the Lord. You have to ask yourself this question. Am I truly a servant of the Lord? You know, we have people who get saved and they get the fire insurance paid and they're happy. They're on their way to heaven. That's all they really care about. They like to go through the motions from time to time. On Sunday, maybe show up at church as frequently as they can, as long as it's not inconvenient. And just take part and then go their way the rest of the week and not let their Christianity affect their lives too much in any way. They really are not serving the Lord. They're letting the Lord serve them, they think. Are you truly a servant of the Lord? Every born-again believer should be. We're saved to serve, and we should be his servants. So, all of us who are servants of the Lord, praise his name. Now, the Hebrew original used here in this text means this: to be clear, to shine, to make a show, to boast, and thus to be clamorously foolish, to rave about something. Oh my goodness. I like that stuff. You know what I'm saying? To be clamorously foolish. That just sounds so much fun to me, just to go around being foolish, praising the Lord. Here's what we need to do. You see, the outside world looks at us Christians, and all too often they don't see us being any different from them, except for the fact that we do go to church and we think we're holier than they are. How about if we just started being clamorously foolish about our love for the Lord all the time, everywhere we are, so they always see that displayed on us? I think that'd be just a wonderful, wonderful thing. It is something that can't be kept quiet. It has to be expressed. Lauren picked the music. She had no idea what I was preaching about today. That very first course we opened the service with, now some of you weren't here, but it had to do with boasting in the Lord. I sat there and got the heebie-jeebies. That happens to me all the time. When I haven't told the music people what I'm preaching about, but everything they prepare to sing ties right into the sermon. I just think that's God at work. I love it. I love it. In Hebrews 34:2, my soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear of it and be glad. You see, people are supposed to see our praise for that Lord to the point that it makes them happy to be around us and makes them happy to know that he's there. And we can do that by just really boasting in the Lord all the time. You know what happened when Jesus was making his entry into Jerusalem there? What we call the triumphal entry, riding on a donkey, and they were throwing their coats on the road, and everybody was hollering, Hosanna to the King, Hosanna to the King. You know, the Jewish leaders, the religious leaders, got really jealous about that. They didn't want Hosanna to anybody but themselves. So they said, to the Lord, make them shut up, make them hush. And you know what Jesus said? Answer said to them, I tell you that if these should keep silent, the stones would immediately cry out. The universe out here around us knows that God is to be praised. And I love looking at nature because I see God everywhere I look. I hope you do as well. I tell people I love looking at the mountains. I think mountains are wonderful. I can look up there and I can see the glory of God all around that place. And it looks better when there's either snow or green on them. But anyway, brown, still, he's there. He's there. And I love going up in there in the springtime when the little tiny alpine flowers are blooming. I can get out of my car and go walk across the field and bend over and look at a little tiny flower by that big. And I can see all the glory of the Lord in that, just like I can the entire mountain range. Everything in nature knows that God is to be praised. If you and I want to have the best, most blessed new year of our lives coming up, let's get it in our minds what we're to do is to praise the Lord. When? That's another one of the big W's that investigative reporters ask. And it's right there in our text. Verse number 2 says, blessed be the name of the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. When are we to praise the Lord? Forever. Forever. You just never stop. It becomes who we are. It's what we do all the time. And look at, I got a note here from right now until the end of eternity, and we all know that that will be, will not ever be an end to eternity. We just to praise the Lord forever, starting right now, then forever. And then verse 3 says, from the rising of the sun to its going down, the Lord's name is to be praised always, all day long, every day, forever. Our lives should praise the Lord who loved us, who saved us. We're to praise him. And let everything in us just praise him. There's a, you know, the verse of scripture says, pray without ceasing. We'll fit it into the sermon down toward the end. But there's that verse that says, pray without ceasing. Be in constant communication with God. Now, there's there are benefits to that, of course. If you're praying without ceasing, you're always in touch with him. But he's also always on your mind. And if you understand who God is and what he's done for you, if he's on your mind, you're not going to be able to not praise him. It's just going to happen automatically. Pray without ceasing. I tell people all the time, for all the years I've been a pastor, when you pray, okay, give him your shopping list. He wants to know those things. But spend a lot of time listening too, because what God has to say is more important really than what you have to say. So just open. I used to have a practice. I did it for many, many years. I'd start my day out, you know, have some Bible reading, and I'd pray. And at the end of my prayer, I'd say, now, Lord, let's keep the lines of communication open all day. I want to hear what you got to say. I did that for years. I finally got it in my mind. He's got it now. I don't have to tell him that anymore. He's figured it out. That's what I want. But there's something about praying without ceasing. It doesn't mean you have to stay on your knees or your head bowed and your lips moving on. Just stay in constant contact with the Lord. There are benefits to that. I want to give you one quick example about the things that can happen when you stay in constant touch with the Lord. Back in November, we're on our way to Moldova on our mission trip. Elliot Bercot was among the team that went. We're going through that cattle drive at the Treviso Airport, that where all your dignity is laid aside and you're treated like just a nobody. You know, the indignation of it all, I hate that, and I'm sure you do too. And I started thinking about how just one moment in time has created all this havoc. The moment that Osama bin Laden got that idea about the Twin Towers and all that stuff, that moment has changed the world for hundreds of millions of people all over the world from September 2001 until now. Hundreds of millions of people. My lives have been changed by that one moment in time when Osama bin Laden conceived that idea and decided to act on it. And as I was sharing that with Elliot, and I paused and I said, you know, there's a sermon in there somewhere. Now, I'm you know, try to be a good, responsible preacher. I know we're going to be preaching. I got all my sermons laid out. I know exactly what I'm going to talk about, when and where and how. I know what I'm going to be doing. But here comes this new idea. I'd spend hours preparing some of those sermons. No. On this particular day, when you're in that community center and all the people from the village come, the teachers and the lawyers, stuff, I want you to put that sermon aside and preach this one. What? A moment in time. Okay. I probably spent 15 minutes. The sermon came in a package. It required no preparation from me. I got up in that audience that day and I talked about how 9-1-1, that Osama bin Laden's moment in time, changed everybody's life. And then I talked about other things, the moment you stand before the preacher or whoever and he says, do you take this person to be your lawful wedded? And you have that moment there where you could escape if you wanted to, but you don't. You say, I do, and your life changes. And there's that moment your first little child comes into the world in that delivery room, and your life just changed radically. You're going to be a parent for the rest of your life. There's no escaping it. And then I talked about the moment in time that can change your eternity. And about half that audience that day said yes to Jesus. By actual count, 61 people said yes to Jesus. Now, if I had been the kind of person who says, okay, amen, bye, I would never have had that idea. I would have preached what I had, and probably a dozen or so people would have got saved. They always do over there. But on this particular day, the largest response to an invitation we've ever had in Moldova occurred today simply because I kept the lines of communication open. And listen, I'm not bragging about my hearing. I'm bragging about his speaking, so don't get that wrong. Always, we're to praise him forever and always. The Bible tells us we have this intimate privilege of calling God Abba, which means daddy. Romans 8:15, Galatians 4:6. In Mark 14:36, this was the title Jesus used in the Garden of Gethsemane when he cried out, Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Take this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. We have the privilege of calling God our daddy and staying in touch with him always. God is our divine daddy. He allows us that level of intimacy with him. He opened the door to that. The daddy element in him loves to have us talk to him. The divine element in him loves to talk back to us. So let's learn to keep the doors open always. Colossians 3:2 says, set your mind on things above, not on things of the earth. Set your mind on things above. Where are we to praise the Lord? Where should we praise him? Well, I'm retired Air Force, and during the time I was on active duty, you know, I got a couple of bad assignments. I knew a lot of other people got bad assignments. We'd always complain about the assignments we got that we didn't want, but somewhere down the road somebody came up with this idea. Well, you know, everybody's got to be somewhere all the time. So you just might as well go ahead and get over it. Well, if we understand that we're to praise God forever, always, then it naturally follows that wherever we are, whatever we're doing, praise should be a part of it. It doesn't matter if you're here or Korea or, I talked to a guy last night who actually wants to go to Alaska. I don't know about that. Anyway, I thought he was a smart guy too, but anyway. I always want to go, and Deli said, I'll see you when you get back. So I never did go to Alaska. Wherever you are, whatever your circumstances, wait a minute now, preacher, come on. Sometimes there's some circumstance so bad in my life, I just don't feel like praising anybody. Hey, that's when you need to praise him the most. That's when you need to praise him the most. God, during your difficult circumstances, is doing something. You don't know what it is. He's not finished yet. You have to wait. But he's up to something, and somehow or another, it's going to work out to your good. So praise him even then. I want to give you a hot tip. Adele and I, there's a game show on Italian TV Adele and I watch from time to time. This guy named Jerry Scotti, he's the big TV personality here in Italy, and he's on his game show, and one of the questions was, what phrase from the Lord's Prayer has the Pope chosen to eliminate? Wait a minute. The Pope has chosen to eliminate a part of the Lord's Prayer? Excuse me? Yeah. He has taken upon himself that power. And the one he's chosen to eliminate is the one that says, deliver us from temptation. Because God wouldn't ever tempt anybody. That's his reasoning. Well, what he does is he's shown just a gross ignorance of the scripture, first of all. The word temptation, it can, from the original in both Hebrew and Greek, it can mean, okay, an enticement to sin. But it can also mean a trial, tribulations, you know, the kind of test that God puts in your life sometimes to prove you or to prepare you. I've been thinking about tweeting the Pope, sir, can I come sit down with you for a few minutes? I want to talk to you about something here. If you ever get to heaven, I don't think you're going to, but if you should, talk to Joseph and ask him, will the Lord let people pass through temptations? Talk to Daniel and the three Hebrew boys, the lion's den, the fiery furnace. Talk to Paul about his beatings and his shipwrecks. Does the Lord let trial? Yes, he does. So why are you taking that out of the Lord's Prayer? Who do you, sir, think you are? Well, wherever you are, whatever you're doing, praise should be part of it. Now, who? Guys, we're going through, we're asking the who, what, when, where, why, and how of praising the Lord. Who? We've already seen it is the Lord. I mean, the text is very clear about that. But I want you to look with me at verses 4 and 5 just for a moment. The Lord is high above all nations, his glory above the heavens. The ultimate God. The ultimate God. The highest of all who ever existed. I want to share something with you. Please don't ever be guilty of saying, I serve a higher power. People say that all the time, don't they? Well, there are lots of higher powers. You serve your boss at work. Maybe you serve your wife at home. there are higher powers everywhere. Say, no, I serve the highest power, the ultimate. That's who I'm praising. That's who I'm serving. Even here in my job, as I do whatever you're telling me to do, I'm serving him. He is the ultimate. And then in verse 5, it says, who is like the Lord our God who dwells on high? Not only is he the ultimate, he is the unique, the one and only. There is no one else like him. No one else. No one else ever spoke and the universe came into existence. No one else ever looked down at rebellious human men and said, in spite of their rebellion and their sin, I'm going to love them and pay the price. No one ever did that other than Jehovah God. He is unique. You don't serve a higher power. If you're a servant of God, you serve the highest power. There's a grand old hymn we used to hear a lot when I was a child, and you understand that's ancient history, I know. But it's called How Big Is God? And in the one of the verses, though man may strive to go beyond the reach of space, to crawl beyond the distant shimmering stars, the world's a room so small within my master's house, the open sky but a portion of his yard. You're praising the ultimate, unique, one and only God, capital G. That's who you're praising. Why should we do it? I love what verse 6 says. And this ties in. It's so good to come right here the week after Christmas because it explains what happened at Christmas time. Verse 6 says, who humbles himself to behold the things that are in the heavens and in the earth? Who humbles himself? Only Jehovah God. That's what happened at Christmas. He came down to earth. He humbled himself. I have in my computer here, I have a thing called the Olive Tree Bible. And in the introduction to this psalm, they call it the majesty and the condescension of God. That choice of words gives us a wonderful insight into why we should praise God constantly, all day, every day, until the day when we all see him face to face. He condescended to come down to earth to consider us, to behold us, to live among us, to experience the things we experience, to relate to us in a real human way. He condescended. That's what we just finished celebrating. That's what Christmas is all about. And he looks down from heaven and earth upon us, considers us, loves us. That is why we should praise him forever and always. Psalm 144, verses 3 and 4. I just put the references up here. You want to write them down, you can, and have them to take home with you, but I didn't put the whole text. Lord, what is man that you take knowledge of him, or the son of man that you are mindful of him? Man is like a breath, his days like the passing shadow. What is man that you should even think about him? We're sinners. We're rebels. Of all the things that God created back there in Genesis 1 and 2, of all the things he ever put into existence, everything is doing exactly what he programmed it to do, except you and me. We sinned. We broke God's commandments. And yet he looks down from heaven, takes knowledge of us. He humbles himself to behold not only the things on earth, but the things in heaven. You realize God has to humble himself to even consider the things that are right there in heaven beside him. And then he looks down upon us. That same hymn, How Big Is God, the chorus goes like this. How big is God? How big and wide his vast domain? To try and tell, these lips can only start. He's big enough to rule his mighty universe. yet small enough to live within my heart. Oh, do you have reasons to praise God? Yes, you and I do. We have to praise him while we're here, while we're alive. Psalm 115, 17 through 18 says, the dead do not praise the Lord, no any who go down into silence, but we will bless the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. Praise the Lord. That's our job. Years ago, I was sending out daily devotional lessons from the Psalms through email and other things, and some people here in the church got after me. They thought the stuff was pretty good and said it ought to be in a book so people can have it. So I let them bully me around a little bit, and I took some money out of my own pocket and paid to publish a book. And I tell you that because I'll never get that money back. But anyway, I didn't make the New York Times bestseller list. Let's put it that way. But I was writing on the last psalm, one verse in Psalm 150. And these are the words I wrote, and I'm going to just read them to you. I still have the copy of the book at home, and I read it sometime, and I actually impress myself. It's pretty good stuff in there. Too bad not hardly anybody knows about it. But anyway, they, means all the writers of the Psalms, have praised and prayed, pouted and protested. They have exalted, exhorted, extolled, explained, and expounded about God, his mercy, and his mighty works. At the end of the Psalms, they string together five songs of nothing but praise. Surely there's a reason for this. Whenever we have considered everything we know about God, said all that we can say about God, explained all that we understand about God, and looked upon all the works of God, we must come to one simple conclusion. God must be praised. You want to have a happy new year in 2019? Praise God every day, all day, wherever you are, whatever you're doing. Now, we rather inadequately explored all these W's, but we've come down to that terrible question now. How am I to do that? How am I to do that? Well, the answers are in the Bible, but let me just give you a few thoughts. Praising God is not about lip service. It is about life service. It's one thing to come together and sing his praises. You know, I have some subscriptions to things I get in my email there from different praise, you know, kinds of stuff. And sometimes I'll get something somebody somewhere thinks is really good. It'll be some very open, very bold sinner singing a Christian song. And you know they're sinners because you read about their lifestyle, you know, in People magazine, everywhere else. You know what kind of people they are, yet they're singing a song, and everybody's all happy because they're singing a praise song. That's worth nothing. Their lives don't praise God, just their lips. The how has to do with a life service. While we should verbalize our praise and adoration of our wonderful Lord, we must ensure that our words are backed up by a life of consistent submission to and obedience of the one who loved us and gave himself for us. We should begin to think in terms of praise living, not just praise giving. What happens on Sunday should be the overflow of a week of praise living that makes our worship here acceptable while we prepare for another week of praise living that is attainable. You know, the Hebrews, their Sabbath day, they went the last day of the week so they could atone for the sins of the previous week. In the new relationship we have with God through Jesus Christ, we come on the first day of the week to prepare ourselves for the week ahead. What's behind is already forgiven. We don't have to atone for that anymore. It's been atoned for. We're preparing for a week ahead. And we come here on Sunday morning to prepare ourselves for a week that's going to be praising God all week long. So when we come back here next week, our praise overflows from a week of praise living. There's a fellow named David King, pastor of Concord Baptist Church, Chattanooga, Tennessee. There's a book called Forgotten Songs. It's all about the Psalms, about how they ought to be brought back and incorporated into worship. And in this, his comments here, David King wrote, "Don't we wish, pastors, that the mouths of our people were filled with robust prayer, that their homes echoed not only with sounds of television and iPods, but with singing to the Lord, that the fullness of their private worship overflowed into our corporate gatherings, that our public worship would in turn enliven their personal devotion, that the two things would just come together and be a life of constant praise living?" Yeah, we wish that. We wish that. It would be just wonderful if that could happen. The Bible has the instructions about how to live a life of constant praise. Colossians 1, 9 through 12. "For this reason we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and ask that you be filled with the knowledge of his will and all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that you may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing him, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power, for all patience and long-suffering with joy, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light." Hebrews 13, 15, 16. "Therefore, by him let us continually offer the sacrifice of praise to God, that is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. But do not forget to do good and to share, for with such sacrifices God is well pleased." On and on it goes. You find instructions for praise living all through your Bible. And that's what God approves of. That's what he accepts. That's what makes your verbal expression of praise acceptable in his eyes. It flows from a life. It flows from a life that is a life of praise. You wished all the people you love happy or blessed New Year. You have or you will. How many, up to this point, have taken time to look toward heaven and say, "Abba, we're coming into a new year. And above all that I wish for all the people I love, I want you, my Father in heaven, to have a really happy new year in me." Have you ever done that? It's the kind of thing that can change your life. I know I'm preaching to the choir, but understand this. I know choirs have to have rehearsal and repetition. So I don't feel guilty about saying these things to you. We need to be refreshed on these things. I don't know what your favorite Christmas carol is. "Oh, Holy Night is Mine." We'll be, I think, forever and ever. But in that Christmas carol, there's this one little line. "Let all within us praise his holy name." Let all that is within us praise his holy name. That is how you can have the best year of your life. If you make it a year where praising Almighty God is the top priority in everything you do, you go around day by day, hour by hour, with a conscious awareness of his presence in your life and of your commitment to him, to praise him in all that you do, you'll have a year like none other, like none you've ever had before. I don't know if a sermon like this moves anyone out there to need to make a decision. You may be one of those casual Christians who've never really thought it your responsibility to live a life that's constantly praising God in all you do. You may want to come and kneel at this altar here and just pray while we sing our hymn of invitation. What I want you to do is leave here with a conscious awareness of the fact that, listen, if I want God to have a happy new year in my life, there are things I must do correctly. And God will be very happy with me all year long. And you do want that, don't you? Because you want a blessed new year. Father, thank you for who you are, all that you are, all that you have done for us. Lord, we thank you. We ask you to open our hearts and lives. Show us the possibility of living a life of nonstop praise unto you, so you can be exalted in us and the world around will see and be attracted to you through us. We pray for that in Jesus' name.